SQL Server has a lot of settings, some that are set by default and some that are not. Today, hear from Erik Darling in this Data Exposed exclusive all about the good and the bad setting. This week on Data Exposed. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed. Today, we have a special episode, an exclusive episode, where we're bringing on Erik Darling. Erik, thanks so much for joining us today. Can you tell us a little bit about who you are and what you do?
Sure, absolutely. My name is Erik Darling. If you ever want to get in touch with me, these are the various ways to do it. I'm a SQL Server performance tuning consultant. Some people, even Bob Ward was actually at one point nice enough to call me an expert, so I'm feeling pretty good about that.
Awesome. Well, no, we definitely know you as an expert in the community and the SQL space. And I'm really excited because today we're going to be talking about all the settings that you can or can't or shouldn't set in SQL Server. And so I'd love to just understand a little bit more about like why you think this is important.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. So, in my work as a consultant, most of everything I do is SQL Server performance tuning. And there are just a lot of settings out there in the world that I end up telling a whole lot of different clients to flip the switch on for various reasons. Now, there are some settings that are just obviously good things to change because these are all settings that are like great guardrails for your workload to make sure that absolutely nothing flies off the hinges. There are also some settings that are pretty bad ones to change that can have really detrimental performance effects on your server. And so I'm trying to focus in on just the ones that when I have clients change them or I say, hey, it would be really good for you to turn this one on or even sometimes turn it off because turning off a bad setting is sometimes just as good as turning on a good setting. These are the ones that really tend to solve a lot of problems for them all at once. So that's what I think what we're doing here today.
Awesome. No, yeah. And I think we're going to enter a rapid fire. But the one question I have before we get into it is, why aren't all these things just set on by default?
That's a great question. I don't know. I think you probably sit closer to the people who build the installer than I do. So you might ask them someday.
So some of these you're saying like you should just think like maybe these should be the defaults that people should think about.
Yeah, absolutely. And, some of them have made it into the installer recently. I don't want to be totally unfair. And I think Microsoft has done a great job of putting more of these settings like right up in front of people's faces to be like, hey, you need to take care of this before you run SQL Server. Otherwise, as soon as this database or workload gets past a certain point, you're going to start having a real bad time.
Yep, absolutely. Yeah. And I know like backward compat and some things there fall into it. But anyways, that's not what we're here to discuss. We're here to discuss.
Don't get me started, Anna.
Your perspective. And I know we have a lot of things, so we're going to go right into it. The first
one
is min server memory.
Oh, boy. Bad. I got to tell you, this one's a stink bomb, Anna. This one stinks to high heaven. What I see a lot of people do out there is not just turn it up a little bit, they turn it up all the way and make it the same thing as max server memory. And as soon as you start doing that, all sorts of things other than the buffer pool start having a really hard time getting and holding onto memory. And that's something you probably don't want to happen during the middle of your busy production workload.
So your recommendation is just don't set anything here.
Here's a funny one. Since you mentioned why aren't these things a default, min server memory is the default of zero. It's people who go out of their way to change it to something bad. Like they'll ignore all the good settings that we're going to talk about and focus in on this one and say, nope, min server memory has to be the same as max server memory. And boy, howdy, is that a bad time for that.
Okay, got it. So min server memory, leave it default.
Yeah.
Okay. Next one, lock pages in memory. Good or bad?
Anna, I love this one. I love it so much. Especially on some of those big honking SQL servers that people pay a ton of money for. Max server, lock pages in memory. We skipped right to the other one. Lock pages in memory allows you to do all sorts of interesting things with memory that setting min server memory doesn't do, like allocate a whole bunch of RAM to SQL Server without cutting off exactly and telling SQL how it can use that memory. Really, lock pages in memory is what you want when you crank min server memory up, just without all the bad stuff. Even better, on huge servers, it allows you to bypass virtual memory and just allocate physical memory directly to SQL Server. So when you're like doing all sorts of memory intensive stuff, it can really make things better and faster.
Awesome. Cool. Okay. Got it. Okay. Next one is target recovery interval. And I got to be honest, I don't even know what this is.
Really? Oh man, well, you should check out my training. It's really reasonably priced. So target recovery interval does this neat thing where, you know, for years I would look through people's error logs and I would see all these messages about flush cache where SQL Server was spending like 60 seconds or longer trying to write dirty pages from the buffer pool out to disk, either because they started taking a backup or something else forced a checkpoint to occur, and they would just drag on and on and on. Changing target recovery interval to 60 seconds, if you're on SQL Server 2012 or better, it works. But in SQL Server 2016, it did become the default for any new databases you create. Where you have to worry about it is on those big old legacy databases that you've been restoring around since 2005 or so that might not have gotten the attention they need with this setting.
Got it. Okay, got it. So if you've been a newer version, I'm good. I don't need to know what this is.
Well, if you create your database on a newer version, you don't. But if you are, trucking that legacy database around for a long time, you might want to check this one out.
Yep, makes sense. Okay, got it. Okay, cool. Next is optimize for ad hoc workloads.
This one here is one that people have been saying for years is a best practice, that Microsoft said it was a best practice. Someone who had a blog once said it was a best practice. And it's just really just makes your plan cache weird. And the reason why I hate it as a consultant is because when people hire me, they have performance problems. And if I have to go look in the plan cache for performance problems, maybe because they were also very silly and didn't turn on query store, then all of these queries that run once and run terribly don't have actual query plans that you can go and look at. They just have these tiny little plan stubs. And so I can't do any of my sort of like natural analysis work on them, because what do I have to look at? A stub? Anna, who wants to look at a stub?
Got it. So is there an alternative to using optimized by ad hoc workloads?
So I think what people expect out of optimized for ad hoc workloads is actually what they get out of forced parameterization, where you actually get better plan reuse and you don't clutter up the plan cache with a bunch of nonsense, but you still get the full-fledged execution plans.
Got it. Okay. Good to know. Cool. Yeah. Okay. Next one is resource governor. Good or bad?
Resource governor. When I use it, it is fantastic. And the reason why I end up using it is because by default, any single query can come along and ask for 25% of your Mac server memory setting for a memory grant. On servers with hundreds of gigs or even terabytes of memory, that can take a really big chunk out of a lot of things. Even worse than that is there's only so much memory that SQL Server is willing to give out to memory grants. And the sooner you hit that level, the sooner you have queries start sitting around waiting to just get memory to run. And that can be a real bad time for a lot of people. So when I use Resource Governor, it's when people have big enterprise edition SQL servers and they have queries that are asking for like 450, 500, 600 gigs of memory to run, and they hardly use any of it because SQL Server kind of overestimated how much memory these queries needed, and they just end up wiping out like hundreds of gigs of buffer pool space to accommodate these memory grants.
Yikes. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a big yikes. Huge yikes.
All right. Next is accelerated database recovery, or ADR.
If you ever see Perry walking around, you have to just give him a hug for me. He is an elusive character. But a fellow named Perry, who works at Microsoft, worked on this feature. And I think it is one of the coolest things that Microsoft has added to their product in a long time. Not only does it give you like really fast startup and really fast failover, not only does it give you roll back transactions that may have been running for a long time instantly, but it also works really well with read committed snapshot isolation and snapshot isolation, where it moves the version store data that they generate from Temp DB, where if you have a lot of databases that are all using those settings, you can really clutter up Temp DB with a lot of that stuff. What this does is allow you to read off the local version store rather than going up to Temp DB for it, and that can even make that one of my other favorite features work even better.
Awesome. Got it. And I have one more question on this one, because this one, along with read committed snapshot isolation, those are not on by default. So do you recommend this for everybody? Or do you think it depends?
So I do recommend it for everybody, but I recommend it for a lot of people who are still using the default read committed isolation level, because you run into a lot of weird problems with that one. I think if you wanted to read some tea leaves on that, you might ask why Microsoft made read committed snapshot isolation the default for Azure SQL DB, because I think as soon as they had to start dealing with customer locking and blocking problems, they were like, no way.
Yep. Got it. Okay. I will not make a comment on that, but good thinking. The next one is optimistic isolation.
Oh, how do you know? All right. So I do think these should be the default because you get rid of all those lousy no-lock hints that return dirty data to your poor end users. You get multi-version concurrency control, which is how nearly every other database platform operates, including the current darling in the spotlight, Postgres. It fixes all the nasty reader on writer blocking and deadlocking issues that you can hit in SQL Server under read committed. And, again, it pairs beautifully with accelerated database recovery. I think those two features together probably make any database that I look at just feel comfy.
Awesome. Great. Okay, cool. Next is in-memory Temp DB.
Yes, it's wonderful. It resolves so many weird leftover performance issues that you can see with Temp DB contention. You know, it used to be that, back in the prehistoric days of pre 2016, when you still had to enable trace flags like 1117 and 1118. But, again, Microsoft, good job on making those a default in 2016. You would still have this weird leftover performance issues, even if you had all the TempDB files that your system should have. And this next level of it, the in-memory TempDB stuff, really just solves a ton of things. I'm actually really excited with the stuff that the enhancements they've added to it and that you've added to it. Microsoft, not some nebulous they have added to it in SQL Server 2022.
Cool. Awesome. Okay. Now this next one is one I briefly kind of mentioned earlier. Ooh. Not really, but DB compat levels. What's your thoughts here?
Oh, so this is one where you have to approach it with a lot of fear and trepidation because, on the one hand, you, Anna, are Microsoft, you introduce so many cool things in these new compat levels, so many useful new features and, T-SQL linguistic capabilities. But on the other hand, when you flip the compat level up past SQL Server 2014, you run into lots and lots of angry bees. What I see a lot of people run into is that the new cardinality estimator that gets switched to when you up the compatibility level from a lower one to a higher one, they can really mess things up because you've had these queries that have been chugging along for years using the old cardinality estimator, and everything's going great, and all of a sudden they meet this new one and they're like, wait a minute, first date, I wasn't prepared for this. So you have to be really careful in there. But as far as the optimizer features from the IQP family that get introduced, some of the optimizer fixes and changes that get rolled out when you up the compatibility level, I think there's a lot of really promising, really useful things that you get out of it. So what I see a lot of people do is they will up the compatibility level to one of the newer ones with all the great stuff locked behind it, but they'll change one of the database scope configurations to still use the legacy cardinality estimator because the pairing of the two just works really well together.
Got it. That's a good pro tip. Mm-hmm. Okay. So we went through all of these really, really, really fast. I have to ask you any final tips and tricks?
Yes. Hire me.
Hire you. Okay. All right. We'll end on that. I'm happy with that. For folks, if you watched this episode, go ahead, give it a like, leave us a comment, let us know what you think. We'll put Eric's info in the description if you want to learn more or if you would like to hire Eric. I heard he is open to that. And we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.
Bye. Thank you.